Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Popular Survey of the New Testament by Norman L. Geisler, narrated by Jim Denison. Publisher's note, this audiobook contains bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type A Popular Survey of the New Testament into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code GOSPEL. And then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All figures, tables, and appendices referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. 1. A Christ-centered introduction to the Bible. Introduction. Jesus said 5 times that he was the theme of the entire Bible. Once is enough to draw our attention to the fact, and 5 times makes it an important teaching of our Lord. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, it says, "Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill." In Luke chapter 24, verse 27, it says, "And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." In Luke chapter 24, verse 44, it says, "All things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me." In John chapter 5, verse 39, it says, "You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of me." In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 7, it says, "Behold, I have come, in the volume of the book it is written of me, to do your will, O God." Of course, the New Testament was not yet written when Jesus uttered these words. However, most people have no problem understanding that Jesus is the theme of the New Testament. In the Gospels, Jesus is the prophet to his people. In Acts and the Epistles, Jesus is the priest for his people. In the book of Revelation, Jesus is the king over his people. But what about the Old Testament? It is not clear to all that the entire Old Testament is about Christ. This will become more evident as the next 3 points unfold. First of all, Jesus is the theme of both testaments. St. Augustine put it succinctly, "The new is in the old concealed. The old is in the new revealed." Christ is implicit in the old and explicit in the new. In the Old Testament, the Rose of Sharon is just budding, but in the New Testament, it is in full bloom. The whole Bible is about Jesus. Jesus is the theme of both testaments. In the Old Testament, anticipation of Christ. In the New Testament, realization of Christ. In the Old Testament, he is coming. In the New Testament, he is arrived. In the Old Testament, he is prophesied. In the New Testament, he is present. In the Old Testament, he is contained. In the New Testament, he is explained. In the Old Testament, he is enfolded. In the New Testament, he is unfolded. In the Old Testament, he is in shadow. In the New Testament, he is in substance. In the Old Testament, he is found in type. In the New Testament, he is found in truth. Jesus in every section of the Bible. The Bible is divided into 8 major sections, 4 in the Old and 4 in the New. In each Old Testament section, there is a different direction. 1. Law, downward look. There are 5 books of the law, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. In these books, God moves down into human history by choosing a nation, Genesis, redeeming them, Exodus, sanctifying them, Leviticus, guiding them, Numbers, and instructing them, Deuteronomy. 2. History, outward look. In the next 12 books of the Old Testament, there is an outward look. Moses brought Israel out of bondage, but Joshua took them into the blessing of the promised land. God had to get the holy nation into the holy land so they could bring forth the holy Son of God, the Savior, and the Holy Word of God, the Scriptures. In Joshua, they possessed the land. In Judges, they were oppressed by the people of the land. Ruth is a lily in contrast to the mud pond of Judges. It is a story of faithfulness in a day of unfaithfulness. In 1 Samuel, the nation is established under Saul, the people's choice. In 2 Samuel, the nation is expanded under David, God's choice. In 1 Kings, the nation is declining because of polygamy, idolatry, and disunity. In 2 Kings, the nation is deported, the northern 10 tribes going into Assyria in 722 BC, and the southern 2 tribes, Judah and Benjamin, going into captivity under Babylon in 605 BC. In Ezra, the remnant of the nation is returned. In Nehemiah, they are rebuilt, and in Esther, they are protected. Thus, the messianic nation returns to its land and begins to rebuild, preparing for the coming Messiah. 3. Poetry, upward look. By the end of the historical books, Nehemiah, we are at the end of the Old Testament at about 400 BC. So all the poetic and prophetic books fit back into this historical structure. This can be illustrated by a biblical bookshelf, see figure 1.1, which can be found in the accompanying bonus material. The poetic books show the aspiration of the nation for Christ in spiritual and moral matters. In Job, aspiration is for mediation, see chapter 9, verse 33, of which Christ is the ultimate fulfillment, see 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. In Psalms, the aspiration is for communion with God, which is also fulfilled in Christ, who taught us to pray, see Matthew chapter 5, verses 5 through 15. Proverbs manifests the aspiration for wisdom, which Christ personified, for in him are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, see Colossians chapter 2, verse 3. In Ecclesiastes, the aspiration is for ultimate satisfaction, see chapter 1, verse 8, found only in the one shepherd, see chapter 12, verses 11 through 13. And in the Song of Solomon, the aspiration is for intimate union with the lover of our souls. Hence, all the poetic books find their ultimate focus in Christ. 4. Prophecy, forward look. The last 17 books of the Old Testament look forward to Christ. These prophetic books are divided into two sections. The five major prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, and Daniel, and the minor prophets, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. The prophets all looked forward in anticipation of Christ. Before the 70-year captivity, the exile, the prophets, including Isaiah, Jeremiah, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, and Zephaniah, stressed exhortation. The prophetic books, written during the captivity, were Lamentations, which looked back in lamentation on the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple, Ezekiel, which looked forward to Israel's spiritual restoration, and Daniel, which anticipated their political restoration. After the captivity, three books were written. Haggai exhorted the people to build the temple of the present under Zerubbabel, and Zechariah urged them to behold the temple of the future under Christ. While these writers spoke of the nation's spiritual restoration, Malachi wrote of their moral restoration. After Malachi, 400 silent years passed before the fullness of time had come, see Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, and the next Jewish prophet declared, "Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world," see John chapter 1, verse 29. In Christ, the anticipation of the old became the realization of the new. The prophetic expectation became a historical manifestation. 5. Gospels, downward look. In the New Testament, there is an exact four-directional parallel with the four sections of the Old Testament. In the Gospels, there is a downward move. God does not simply act in history as he did in the law, but he entered history in the life of his Son. He does not merely manifest himself in laws for his people, as through Moses, but he manifests himself in the life of his people, through Christ. Christ is manifest as King to the Jews in Matthew as servant to the Romans in Mark, as the perfect man to the Greeks in Luke, and as God to the world in John. 6. Acts, outward look. At the end of the Gospels, Jesus died, rose again, and ascended into heaven. See Luke chapter 24, verse 51, and Mark chapter 16, verse 19. In Acts, he promised the Holy Spirit would come and empower the apostles to be witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea, see Acts chapters 1 through 7, Samaria, see chapter 8, and to the uttermost parts of the earth, see chapters 9 through 28. Herein is the outward movement of the church. 7. Epistles, upward look. Once Jesus ascended to heaven and took his place at the right hand of the Father, see Hebrews chapter 1, verses 2 through 3, he became head over all things to his body, the church, see Ephesians chapter 1, verses 22 through 23. Hence, the church looks upward to its head in the epistles. It is he who through his Spirit gave instructions to the churches through the apostles. Thus they were to build up one another, internally, see Ephesians chapter 4, verses 7 through 16, and reach out, externally, see Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20, to disciple believers in all nations, awaiting his blessed return. See 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18, and Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 14. 8. Revelation, forward look. The last section of the Bible, like the last section of the Old Testament, is prophetic. It looks forward to the consummation of all things in Christ. Not only was the world created by him, see John chapter 1, verse 3, and Colossians chapter 1, verse 16, but it consists, is held together by him, see Colossians chapter 1, verse 17, and Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3, and it will find its consummation in him, see Revelation chapter 11, verse 15. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end of all things. So each of these eight sections of the Bible unfolds in a Christocentric way. 1. Law, foundation for Christ. 2. History, preparation for Christ. 3. Poetry, aspiration for Christ. 4. Prophecy, expectation of Christ. 5. Gospels, manifestation of Christ. 6. Acts, propagation of Christ. 7. Epistles, interpretation of Christ and application. 8. Revelation, consummation in Christ. Christ in every book of the Bible. Christ is the theme of each book in the Bible. Indeed, in most books, Christ is presented in many ways, but there is one significant way he is presented in connection with the theme of each book. Genesis, the seed of the woman. Exodus, the Passover lamb. Leviticus, the atoning sacrifice. Numbers, the smitten rock. Deuteronomy, the prophet. Joshua, our leader. Judges, our deliverer. Ruth, our kinsman redeemer. 1 Samuel, the anointed one. 2 Samuel, the son of David. 1 and 2 Kings, the glorious king. 1 and 2 Chronicles, the priestly king. Ezra, the restorer of the temple. Nehemiah, the restorer of the nation. Esther, our protector. Job, our mediator. Psalms, our all in all. Proverbs, the wisdom of God. Ecclesiastes, the chief good. Song of Solomon, the lover of our soul. Isaiah, the Messiah. Jeremiah, a man of sorrows. Lamentations, the weeping prophet. Ezekiel, the restorer of God's glory. Daniel, the great rock. Hosea, the healer of the backslider. Joel, the hope of his people. Amos, the husbandman. Obadiah, the savior. Jonah, the resurrected one. Micah, the witness. Nahum, the avenger. Habakkuk, the holy God. Zephaniah, the judge. Haggai, the restorer of the temple's glory. Zechariah, the righteous branch. Malachi, the son of righteousness. Matthew, the king of the Jews. Mark, the servant of the Lord. Luke, the son of man. John, the son of God. Acts, our risen Lord. Romans, our righteousness. 1 Corinthians, our sanctification. 2 Corinthians, our sufficiency. Galatians, our liberty. Ephesians, the head of the church. Philippians, our joy. Colossians, the preeminent one. 1 Thessalonians, the coming one. 2 Thessalonians, the glorified one. 1 Timothy, our teacher. 2 Timothy, our helper. Titus, the great God and Savior. Philemon, our substitute. Hebrews, our great high priest. James, our wisdom. 1 Peter, our rock. 2 Peter, our hope. 1 John, the life. 2 John, the truth. 3 John, the way. Jude, our advocate. Revelation, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The bloodline of the Messiah. The Old Testament reveals the progressive narrowing down of the bloodline of the Messiah. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, the seed of the woman. Genesis chapter 4, verse 25, the line of Seth. Genesis chapter 9, verse 27, the son of Shem. Genesis chapter 12, verse 3, the seed of Abraham. Genesis chapter 21, verse 12, the offspring of Isaac. Genesis chapter 25, verse 23, a descendant of Jacob. Genesis chapter 49, verse 10, the tribe of Judah. 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 12 through 16, the son of David. See Matthew chapter 1 and Luke chapter 3, verses 23 through 39. This bloodline is further narrowed to the son of a virgin. See Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, who would be born in Bethlehem. See Micah chapter 5, verse 2. The suffering servant. See Isaiah chapter 53. The dying Messiah, who would be cut off about AD 33. See Daniel chapter 9, verses 24 through 27. One and only one person in history fulfilled all those predictions, Jesus of Nazareth. He claimed to be the Messiah. See John chapter 4, verses 25 through 26, and Mark chapter 14, verses 61 through 62. And he proved to be the Messiah by fulfilling nearly 100 predictions at his first coming. A poetic picture of Christ in Scripture. An anonymous author put the Christ-centered structure of the Bible in this poetic form. I find my Lord in the Bible wherever I chance to look. He is the theme of the Bible, the center and heart of the book. He is the rose of Sharon. He is the lily fair. Wherever I open my Bible, the Lord of the book is there. He, at the book's beginning, gave to the earth its form. He is the ark of shelter, bearing the brunt of the storm, the burning bush of the desert, the budding of Aaron's rod. Wherever I look in the Bible, I see the Son of God. The ram upon Mount Moriah, the ladder from earth to sky, the scarlet cord in the window, and the serpent lifted high, the smitten rock in the desert, the shepherd with staff and crook. The face of my Lord I discover whenever I open the book. He is the seed of the woman, the Savior virgin-born. He is the Son of David, whom men rejected with scorn. His garments of grace and of beauty, the stately Aaron deck, yet he is a priest forever, for he is Melchizedek. Lord of eternal glory, whom John the Apostle saw, light of the golden city, lamb without spot or flaw, bridegroom coming at midnight, for whom the virgins look, wherever I open my Bible, I find my Lord in the book. Study questions. 1. What does Jesus claim about the Scriptures? 2. What is the relation of Jesus in the Old Testament to Jesus in the New Testament? 3. What are the 8 sections of the Bible? How do these sections reveal Christ? 4. How is Christ revealed in each book of the Bible? 5. What does the Old Testament predict about the Messiah? Does Jesus fit the requirements? 2. The Gospel Record, History or Mythology? The reliability of the New Testament depends on the answer to 2 questions. Have the documents been copied accurately? Were the words and events recorded accurately? As we shall learn, the answer to the first question is that we have more manuscripts, earlier manuscripts, and more accurately copied manuscripts of the New Testament than for any other book from the ancient world? And the answer to the second is that we have more books written by more authors who were closer to the events and whose record has been confirmed in more ways than for any other book from the ancient world. The reliability of New Testament manuscripts. As Figure 2.1 in the accompanying bonus material illustrates, the manuscripts of the New Testament are earlier, more abundant, and more accurately copied than any book from antiquity. More New Testament manuscripts. There are over 5,700 Greek manuscripts of the New Testament. Most other books from the ancient world survive based on about 10 to 20 manuscripts. The most manuscripts for any book besides the Bible are for Homer's Iliad with 643. Thus, the New Testament has an overwhelming advantage in the number of manuscripts to support the integrity of the text it is transmitting. Earlier New Testament manuscripts. The New Testament manuscripts are much earlier than those for other books from antiquity. Most other books survive on the basis of manuscripts created 1,000 years after the time the book was composed, there being no known original manuscripts. The New Testament, by contrast, has manuscripts that date from within about 25 years from the time the book was written. John Ryland fragment, circa AD 115 and following, 5 verses from John chapter 18 verses 31 through 33 and verses 37 through 38. Bodmer papyri, AD 200, most of John, 1st and 2nd Peter, and Jude. Chester Beatty papyri, AD 250, nearly all the New Testament books. Vaticanus manuscript, AD 325 to 350, most of Old Testament and New Testament. Noted manuscript expert Sir Frederick Kenyon wrote, "The interval between the dates of original composition and the earliest extant evidence becomes so small as to be, in fact, negligible, and the last foundation for any doubt that the scriptures have come down substantially as they were written has now been removed. Both the authenticity and the general integrity of the books of the New Testament may be regarded as finally established." Better copied manuscripts. The New Testament manuscripts are copied with greater accuracy than other books from the ancient world. Dr. Bruce Metzger of Princeton University and A.T. Robertson compared the accuracy of three great books from antiquity and found the following. The Mahabharata, 90% accuracy. Iliad of Homer, 95% accuracy. The New Testament, 99.9% accuracy. Sir Frederick Kenyon's testimony is to the point. The number of manuscripts of the New Testament, of early translations from it, and of quotations from it in the oldest writers of the church is so large that it is practically certain that the true reading of every doubtful passage is preserved in some one or the other of these ancient authorities. This can be said of no other book in the world. The Testimony of the Fathers. In addition to all of this, if all Greek and ancient translations of the Bible were destroyed, almost the entire New Testament could be reconstructed from the quotations of the Church Fathers from the first few centuries. They cited the New Testament more than 36,000 times. In fact, they provide every verse of the New Testament except for 11 verses. This, too, can be said of no other book from the ancient world. The New Testament has more manuscripts, earlier manuscripts, and more accurately copied manuscripts than any other book from the ancient world. In other words, if we cannot trust the transmission of its text, then we cannot trust any other book that has come to us from antiquity. Figure 2.2. Early Citations of the New Testament. Writer, Justin Martyr. Gospels, 268. Acts, 10. Pauline Epistles, 43. General Epistles, 6. Revelation, 3. 266 allusions. Totals, 330. Writer, Irenaeus. Gospels, 1,038. Acts, 194. Pauline Epistles, 499. General Epistles, 23. Revelation, 65. Totals, 1,819. Writer, Clement of Alexandria. Gospels, 1,017. Acts 44, Pauline Epistles 1127, General Epistles 207, Revelation 11, Totals 2406. Writer, Origin, Gospels 9231, Acts 349, Pauline Epistles 7778, General Epistles 399, Revelation 165, Totals 17922. Writer, Tertullian, Gospels 3822, Acts 502, Pauline Epistles 2609, General Epistles 120, Revelation 205, Totals 7258. Writer, Hippolytus, Gospels 734, Acts 42, Pauline Epistles 387, General Epistles 27, Revelation 188, Totals 1378. Writer, Eusebius, Gospels 3258, Acts 211, Pauline Epistles 1592, General Epistles 88, Revelation 27, Totals 5176. Grand Totals, Gospels 19368, Acts 1352, Pauline Epistles 14035, General Epistles 870, Revelation 664, Totals 36289. The reliability of the New Testament writers. There are two links in the chain of New Testament reliability. First, had the documents been copied accurately? Second, were the words and events recorded accurately? Now that we have learned that there is very strong evidence for an affirmative answer to the first question, let's turn our attention to the second. The answer to this question depends on several factors: the number of the writings, the date of the writings, and the accuracy of the writings. In brief, we can say that the New Testament has more writers, earlier writers, and more accurate writers than any other book from the ancient world. More writers. Most events from the ancient world are known on the basis of one or two writers from the time period or sometime after it. By contrast, the New Testament has nine writers: Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Paul, Peter, James, Jude, and the writer of Hebrews. For the life, works, and words of Christ alone, there were four writers, and as the ancient principle states, in the mouth of two or three witnesses every word shall be established. Nine witnesses is certainly sufficient. In addition, as will be discussed in the upcoming section, all the essential elements of Jesus' life and teaching are preserved in the almost universally accepted epistles of the Apostle Paul. Earlier writers. The New Testament writers were closer to the events than most other writers from the ancient world were to the events about which they wrote. Indeed, many of the New Testament writers were eyewitnesses or contemporaries of the eyewitnesses, and some of them wrote within 20 to 25 years of the events of which they spoke. Jesus died by AD 33, and both Paul and Luke wrote books by about AD 55 to 60. Of the nine New Testament writers, 1. Matthew was an apostle and eyewitness of Christ. See Matthew chapter 10, verse 3. 2. Mark was an associate of the apostle Peter. See 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 13. 3. Luke was an associate of the apostle Paul. See 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 11. 4. John was an apostle and eyewitness. See John chapter 21, verse 24, and 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. 5. Paul was an apostle and contemporary of Jesus. See Acts chapter 9 and 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 8. 6. James was the brother of Jesus and an eyewitness. See 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 7. 7. Peter was an apostle and eyewitness. See Matthew chapter 10, verse 2, and 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 16 through 17. 8. Jude was the brother of James. See Jude, verse 1. 9. The writer of Hebrews was a contemporary of the 12 apostles. See chapter 2, verse 3, and chapter 13, verse 23. John, an eyewitness. John writes the following in John chapter 19, verse 35. And he who has seen has testified to the crucifixion, and his testimony is true. In chapter 21, verse 24, it says, This is the disciple who testifies of these things, and wrote these things, and we know that his testimony is true. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 1, it says, That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, concerning the word of life. Eyewitnesses in Acts. In Acts, we read the testimony of eyewitnesses. This Jesus God raised up to life, of which we are all witnesses. See chapter 2, verse 32. But Peter and John answered, For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. See chapter 4, verses 19 through 20. And we are witnesses of all things which he did both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem, whom they killed by hanging on a tree. Him God raised up from the dead on the third day, and showed him openly. See chapter 10, verses 39 through 40. 500 eyewitnesses of the resurrection. The following was written in AD 55 to 56, when most of the eyewitnesses of the resurrection were still alive. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 4 through 8, it says, He, Jesus, was buried, and he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and he was seen by Cephas, Peter, then by the 12. After that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep. After that, he was seen by James, then by all the apostles. Then last of all, he was seen by me also. Luke, based on eyewitness accounts. Luke states at the beginning of his gospel that what he wrote is based on eyewitness accounts. In Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, New American Standard Bible, it says, Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile an account of the things accomplished among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who, from the beginning, were eyewitnesses and servants of the word, it seemed fitting for me as well, having investigated everything carefully from the beginning, to write it out for you in consecutive order, most excellent Theophilus, so that you might know the exact truth about the things you have been taught. Hebrews confirmed by apostles. The truth of the gospel is confirmed to the writer of Hebrews by the apostles. In Hebrews chapter 2, verses 3 through 4, it says, How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord, and was confirmed to us by those who heard him, God also bearing witness both with signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit, according to his own will. Peter, an eyewitness. Peter affirms that he was an eyewitness to Jesus' life and death. In 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16, it says, For we did not follow cunningly devised fables, myths, when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 1, it says, The elders who are among you I exhort, I who am a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed. Early dates for New Testament books. Not only were the Gospels written by eyewitnesses and contemporaries, but they were written early. Noted Roman historian Colin Hemer has offered numerous lines of evidence that the Book of Acts was written by AD 62. Only five of them are sufficient to make the point. Acts must have been written before the following dates, since these are very important events that no Christian historian writing about the period would have failed to mention if they had already occurred. There is no mention of the fall of Jerusalem, AD 70. There is no reference to the Jewish War, AD 66. There is no hint of Nero's persecutions, circa AD 65. There is no mention of the death of the Apostle Paul, circa AD 65. Indeed, he is still alive in the last chapter of the Book of Acts, see chapter 28. Finally, the Apostle James is still alive, circa AD 62, but the first century Jewish historian Josephus recorded James's death at AD 62. Not mentioning these events in a history of these times would be like writing the life of President Kennedy without mentioning his assassination in 1963. The reader would know that the book was written before 1963. The person who wrote Acts also wrote the Gospel of Luke. Both books are addressed to the same person, Theophilus. See Luke chapter 1, verse 3 and Acts chapter 1, verse 1. The later book mentions the former account. See Acts chapter 1, verse 1. Acts was written by an accurate historian by AD 62 and has been confirmed in nearly 100 details, which could be known only by someone familiar with the facts. Further, Luke chapter 1, verse 1 refers to many, Greek, two or more, narratives on the life of Jesus before him, possibly Matthew and Mark, and claims, as well as proves, to be an accurate account of the matter based on eyewitness testimony, see verse 2. This means we have a good historical account from within 27 to 30 years of the time of the events. Evidence from the early fathers. Overlapping with the time of the apostles and shortly thereafter, there were a number of books that cite the New Testament, thus proving it was in existence at that time. These include the Epistle of Barnabas, 70-90, the Epistles of Clement, 94-95, the Epistles of Polycarp, circa 90-155, the Didache, circa 80-120, the Shepherd of Hermas, 90-100, the Epistles of Ignatius, by 117, an Ancient Homily, 120-40, and Fragments of Papias, 130-40. Early dates for other New Testament books. Even critical scholars agree that 1 Corinthians was written by circa AD 55-56, and 2 Corinthians, Romans, and Galatians were written shortly thereafter. Yet these books provide the same basic information about the life, teaching, death, and resurrection of Christ found in the Gospels. Historical crosshairs. One of the strongest signs of authenticity and reliability found in Luke is the provision of historical crosshairs for the events he records. Not only does he point to the very year Jesus began his ministry, AD 29, but he provides 8 persons known to history to have existed at the same time whose lives intersected with Jesus' life. Luke wrote in chapter 3, verses 1 through 2, "Now in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being governor of Judea, Herod being tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip tetrarch of Iturea and of the region of Trachonitis, and Lysanias tetrarch of Abilene, Annas and Caiaphas being high priests, the word of God came to John, the son of Zacharias, in the wilderness." We should note the following. 1. An exact date is given, the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius, that is, AD 29. 2. All 8 people are known from history. 3. All were known to live at this exact time. 4. This is not a once-upon-a-time story, myth. Are the New Testament books myths? The time between the events of Jesus' life by AD 33 and the earliest records, AD 55-60, is way too short for any significant myths to develop. Indeed, any dates in the first century are too early to allow mythological development, and even radical New Testament critics, like many in the Jesus Seminar, accept that most New Testament books, if not all, were written between AD 70 and 100. As one scholar pointed out, "The writings of the Greek historian Herodotus enable us to test the rate at which a legend accumulates. The tests show that even the span of 2 generations is too short to allow legendary tendencies to wipe out the hard core of historical fact." It should be noted that there are mythological accounts of Jesus, and they appeared at the very time myths should appear, more than 2 generations after the events. The Gospel of Thomas, mid-2nd century, and the other apocryphal Gospels of the 2nd and 3rd centuries following are cases in point. A comparison of the New Testament Gospels and these apocryphal books nearly 100 years later reveals the authentic nature of the former and the embellished, apocryphal nature of the latter. The words of the early Christian expert Edwin Yamauchi serve to summarize the contrast. The apocryphal, pseudepigraphal gospels, even the earliest and soberest among them, can hardly be compared with the canonical gospels. The former are all patently secondary and legendary, or obviously slanted. Commenting on the infancy gospels, Morton Enslin concludes, "Their total effect is to send us back to the canonical gospels with fresh approval of their chaste restraint in failing to fill in the intriguing hidden years." The former atheist and famous myth writer of the Narnia series concluded that the New Testament was not myth. C.S. Lewis declared, "All I am in private life is a literary critic and historian. That's my job. And I am prepared to say on that basis, if anyone thinks the Gospels are either legend or novels, then that person is simply showing his incompetence as a literary critic. I've read a great many novels, and I know a fair amount about the legends that grew up among early people. And I know perfectly well the Gospels are not that kind of stuff." A helpful comparison is that of the records of Christ's life with those of Alexander the Great. In Alexander's case, we have no contemporary eyewitness documents, none. Even 100 years later, there are only fragments. It is not until 300 to 500 years after Alexander's time that we have several biographies of this great military leader. By contrast, the essential elements of the life, teaching, death, and resurrection of Christ were written by contemporaries of Jesus and eyewitnesses to the events of his life and were begun as early as about 20 years after his ministry. Dean of Biblical Archaeology speaks out. William F. Albright began his scholarly career with serious doubts about the authenticity of much of the Bible. After a generation of studying the archaeological evidence, he declared, "In my opinion, every book of the New Testament was written by a baptized Jew between the 40s and the 80s of the 1st century AD, very probably sometime between 50 and AD 75. AD 50 is only 17 years after Jesus died." The Confessions of a Liberal Critic. One of the men credited with the beginning of the Death of God movement several decades ago, liberal theologian Bishop John Robinson, later took a serious second look at the dates for the New Testament in his book, Redating the New Testament. His conclusion was nearly as radical in a conservative direction as his theology had been in a liberal direction. He concluded that the dates for the Gospels should be as follows: Matthew, AD 40 to 60. Mark, AD 45 to 60. Luke, AD 57 to 60. John, AD 40 to 65. The date, AD 40, would be only 7 years after Jesus died. This is indeed a radical redating of the New Testament. Even considering Robinson's later figures of AD 60, if the Gospels were written less than 30 years after Jesus' death, this is much too early for them not to be accurate. The accuracy of New Testament writers. Not only were there more numerous and earlier writers of the New Testament than other books from its time, but they are known to be more accurate for many reasons. The early date of the writings. As we have discussed, the basic New Testament documents on Christ's life were possibly written as early as AD 40 to 60. They were probably penned by AD 55 to 60, and they were most certainly recorded during the lifetimes of the eyewitnesses. Even these later dates are too early for mythological development, much earlier than for other ancient books, like those on Alexander the Great, and certainly early enough to be considered reliable witnesses to the events. Confirmation by other early writings. Not only were the Gospels early enough to be reliable, but the basic information in them is confirmed by the early writings of Paul that are generally accepted, even by most critics, to be written between AD 50 and 61. In these books, Paul confirmed at least 31 facts recorded in the Gospels. 1. The Jewish ancestry of Jesus, see Galatians chapter 3, verse 16. 2. His Davidic descent, see Romans chapter 1, verse 3. 3. His virgin birth, See Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. 4. His life under Jewish law. See Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. 5. He had brothers. See 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 5. 6. He had 12 disciples. See 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 7. 7. One disciple was named James. See 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 7. 8. Some disciples had wives. See 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 5. 9. Paul knew Peter and James. See Galatians chapter 1, verse 18 through chapter 2, verse 16. 10. Jesus' poverty. See 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. 11. His humility. See Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 7. 12. His meekness and gentleness. See 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1. 13. His abuse by others. See Romans chapter 15, verse 3. 14. His teachings on divorce and remarriage. See 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 10 through 11. 15. His view on paying wages to ministers. See 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 14. 16. His view on paying taxes. See Romans chapter 13, verses 6 through 7. 17. His command to love one's neighbors. See Romans chapter 13, verse 9. 18. Jewish ceremonial uncleanness. See Romans chapter 14, verse 14. 19. Jesus' titles of deity. See Romans chapter 1, verses 3 through 4, and chapter 10, verse 9. 20. The need for vigilance in view of Jesus' second coming. See 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 15. 21. His second coming like a thief in the night. See 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 2 through 11. 22. His institution of the Lord's Supper. See 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 25. 23. His sinless life. See 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. 24. His death on the cross. See Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. See Romans chapter 4, verse 25, chapter 5, verse 8, and 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3. 25. His death by crucifixion. See Romans chapter 6, verse 6, and Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. 26. His death by Jewish instigation. See 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 14 through 15. 27. His burial. See 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 4. 28. His resurrection on the third day. See 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 4. 29. His post-resurrection appearance to the apostles. See 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 5 through 8. 30. His post-resurrection appearances to others. See 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 6. 31. His present position at God's right hand. See Romans chapter 8, verse 34. The authentic nature of the writings. The Gospels show every sign of authenticity. They are vivid, fresh, unembellished, detailed, self-incriminating, diverse, but mutually confirming, that is, historical and not mythological. The following points make all of this clear. The writers made no attempt to harmonize their accounts, even though they are harmonizable. They included material that put Jesus in a bad light. They left many difficult passages in their text. They retained many self-incriminating details. They included many demanding sayings of Jesus. They distinguished their words from Jesus' words. They did not deny their testimony under threat of death. They claimed their record was based on eyewitnesses. They had women witnessing the resurrection before men. They challenged readers to check out the facts. They discarded long-held Jewish beliefs overnight. They included more than 30 historical people. 31 historical persons in the New Testament. Another sign of the historical reliability of the New Testament is its accurate presentation of some 31 historical persons. These include 1. Herod Agrippa I, Acts chapter 12. 2. Agrippa II, Acts chapter 25. 3. Ananias, Acts chapters 23 through 24. 4. Annas, Luke chapter 3, John chapter 18, Acts chapter 4. 5. Aretas, 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 6. Augustus, Luke chapter 2. 7. Bernice, Acts chapter 25. 8. Caiaphas, Matthew chapter 26, Luke chapter 3, John chapters 11 and 18, and Acts chapter 4. 9. Claudius, Acts chapters 11 and 18. 10. Drusilla, Acts chapter 24. 11. Egyptian, Acts chapter 21, a false prophet who started a revolt. 12. Erastus, Acts chapter 19. 13. Felix, Acts chapter 23. 14. Gallio, Acts chapter 18. 15. Gamaliel, Acts chapter 5. 16. Herod Antipas, Matthew chapter 14, Mark chapter 6, and Luke chapters 3 and 23. 17. Herod Archelaus, Matthew chapter 2. 18. Herod the Great, Matthew chapter 2 and Luke chapter 1. 19. Herod Philip I, Matthew chapter 14 and Mark chapter 6. 20. Herod Philip II, Luke chapter 3. 21. Herodias, Matthew chapter 14 and Mark chapter 6. 22. James, Acts chapter 15 and Galatians chapter 1. 23. John the Baptist, Matthew chapter 3, Mark chapter 1, Luke chapter 3, and John chapter 1. 24. Judas of Galilee, Acts chapter 5. 25. Lysanias, Luke chapter 3. 26. Pilate, Matthew chapter 27, Mark chapter 15, Luke chapter 23, and John chapter 18. 27. Porcius Festus, Acts chapters 24 through 26. 28. Quirinius, Luke chapter 2. 29. Salome, Matthew chapter 14 and Mark chapter 6. 30. Sergius Paulus, Acts chapter 13. 31. Tiberius Caesar, Luke chapter 3. Confirmation by noted Roman historians. A.N. Sherwin-White, noted authority on Roman society and law, wrote, "So it is astonishing that while Greco-Roman historians have been growing in confidence, the 20th century study of the gospel narratives, starting from no less promising material, have taken so gloomy a turn in the development of form criticism that the historical Christ is unknowable and the history of his mission cannot be written. This seems very curious." He calls the mythological view unbelievable. Another noted expert on the period confirmed nearly 100 details in Acts from Roman sources. This evidence demonstrates that the author of the third gospel was a first-rate historian because of his knowledge of minute geographical details known to the readers, specialized details known only to special groups, specifics of routes, places, and officials that were not widely known, correlation of dates in Acts with general history, details appropriate to that period but not others, events that reflect a sense of immediacy, idioms and culture that bespeak a first-hand awareness, verification of numerous details of times, people, and events of that period best known by contemporaries. Harvard legal expert confirms Gospels. Simon Greenleaf, 1783-1853, professor of law at Harvard University, was one of the greatest legal minds in American history. He wrote a treatise on the law of evidences, 1853, the standard book on legal evidence that was used to train lawyers in how to test evidence and witnesses. When challenged to apply the legal standards to the New Testament, he wrote the Testimony of the Evangelists, 1846 edition, in which he concluded that were the New Testament documents and witnesses so tested in a court of law, they would prove to be reliable. He wrote, "The narratives of the evangelists are now submitted to the reader's perusal and examination upon the principles and by the rules already stated. If they had thus testified on oath in a court of justice, they would be entitled to credit, and whether their narratives, as we now have them, would be received as ancient documents coming from the proper custody. If so, then it is believed that every honest and impartial man will act consistently with that result by receiving their testimony in all the extent of its import." Greenleaf added, "All that Christianity asks of men on this subject is that they would be consistent with themselves, that they would treat its evidences as they treat the evidence of other things, and that they would try and judge its actors and witnesses as they deal with their fellow men when testifying to human affairs and actions in human tribunals. Let the witnesses be compared with themselves, with each other, and with surrounding facts and circumstances, and let their testimony be sifted as if it were given in a court of justice on the side of the adverse party the witness being subjected to rigorous cross-examination. The result, it is confidently believed, will be an undoubting conviction of their integrity, ability, and truth. Non-Christian sources for the New Testament. Another line of supporting evidence for the historical accuracy of the New Testament is found in non-Christian sources outside the New Testament. The two best sources for this information are F.F. Bruce, Jesus and Christian Origins Outside the New Testament, and Gary Habermas, The Historical Jesus. Summarizing the non-Christian writers of the times, such as Josephus, Tacitus, Suetonius, Thallus, the Jewish Talmud, and others, we get the following confirmation of the basic historicity of the New Testament. Jesus was from Nazareth. He lived a virtuous life. He performed unusual feats. He introduced new teaching contrary to Judaism. He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. His disciples believed he rose from the dead. His disciples denied polytheism. His disciples worshipped him. His teaching spread rapidly, and the number of his disciples quickly grew. His followers believed they were immortal. His followers had contempt for death. His followers renounced material goods. Archaeological confirmation of the New Testament. The archaeological evidence for the New Testament's general historicity can be summarized in 2 points. 1. No archaeological evidence has ever refuted the Bible. 2. Abundant archaeological evidence supports the historical reliability of the New Testament. As to the first point, noted biblical scholar Nelson Gleck wrote, "As a matter of fact, however, it may be stated categorically that no archaeological discovery has ever controverted a biblical reference. Scores of archaeological findings have been made which confirm in clear outline or exact detail historical statements in the Bible." On the second point, Donald J. Wiseman wrote, "The geography of Bible lands and visible remains of antiquity were gradually recorded until today more than 25,000 sites within this region and dating to Old Testament times, in their broadest sense, have been located." Summarizing the evidence for U.S. News and World Report, Jeffrey Sheeler wrote, "In extraordinary ways, modern archaeology has affirmed the historical core of the Old and New Testaments, corroborating key portions of the stories of Israel's patriarchs, the Exodus, the Davidic monarchy, and the life and times of Jesus." Some archaeological evidence relating directly to Jesus includes the excavation of his hometown of Nazareth, Pilate's name inscribed in stone, an inscription of Caiaphas the high priest who tried Jesus, the discovery of Johanan, a crucifixion victim from circa AD 70, found in 1968, which verifies the method of crucifixion, and the Nazareth decree of Emperor Claudius, AD 41-54, which forbade removal of bodies from graves under pain of death. This seems to hint at the story that circulated in the wake of Jesus' resurrection. See Matthew chapter 28, verses 11 through 15. Of course, there are numerous other finds in and around Jerusalem that intersect with Jesus' life, including Bethlehem, Bethany, Jericho, the Sea of Galilee, and a multitude of geographical and topological details in the Gospels. On top of this, there is all the evidence, detailed previously, for Luke's historicity through the many persons known to history whom he included in his book and whose lives intersected with that of Jesus. A summary of the evidence. The evidence of the historical reliability of the New Testament is overwhelming. It can be summarized as follows. There are 9 different authors. There are 27 different books. They are based on eyewitness testimony. Early, accepted Pauline letters confirm them. There was not enough time for myths to develop. The nature of the records is authentic. Non-Christian sources support them. Noted Roman historians have confirmed them. Noted legal experts have vouched for them. Many archaeological finds have supported them. Nothing like this evidence exists for any other book from the ancient world. In short, if a person does not accept the authenticity of the New Testament, then logically he or she must reject the evidence for any other event from the ancient world. since all such events are believed to have happened on much less evidence than that available for the New Testament. Hence, when the Gospels say Jesus said it, then Jesus actually said it. And when they say Jesus did it, then Jesus actually did it. Study questions. 1. What is the evidence that the New Testament documents are historically reliable? Why is their reliability important? 2. What are some reasons to trust the New Testament authors? 3. When was the Book of Acts written? Why is this date important? 4. Why are the lists of historical persons in the New Testament significant? 5. What can be known about Jesus outside the New Testament? 3. Introduction to the Gospels. Before we begin our study of the Gospels, it will be helpful to discuss several introductory matters. First, we will examine the overall chronology of the life of Jesus. Chronological indicators in the New Testament. There are certain chronological indicators in the New Testament from which we can begin to build an overall timeline. Some of the evidence is internal and some is external. On the birth of Jesus. The New Testament does not state the year, month, or day of Christ's birth. It simply says it was during the reigns of Caesar Augustus, 31 BC to AD 14, see Luke chapter 2, verse 1, and Herod the Great of Palestine, 4 BC to AD 34, see Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. We know from external sources that Herod reigned from 8 to 4 BC. We also know that the census of Quirinius, which Luke mentioned in chapter 2, verse 2, would have been about 6 BC. Thus, it would appear that Jesus was born between 4 and 6 BC. Being more specific would require speculation and inference. The traditional date of December 25th was probably chosen to correspond with the winter solstice on the Roman calendar, though one cannot say for sure that Jesus was not born at this time. On Jesus' baptism. The Bible places more emphasis on Jesus' baptism and entrance into his ministry than on his birth. This date is fixed firmly by 8 historical crosshairs in Luke chapter 3, verses 1 through 2, which name 8 historical persons who are known to have lived at that time: Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate, Herod, Philip, Lysanias, Annas, Caiaphas, and John the Baptist. Indeed, it says specifically that it was in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, which is known to be AD 29. On Jesus' age at his baptism. According to Luke, Jesus was about 30 years of age, see Luke chapter 3, verse 23, when he was baptized. Luke may be assuming this general age from the Old Testament, which states that this is the minimum age at which a priest could enter his ministry, see Luke chapter 4, verse 3. However, since Jesus was born during Herod's reign, which ended in 4 BC, it follows that he must have been at least 33 at his baptism. On Jesus' death. We know the time of year, but not the exact year of Jesus' death. It was Passover time, see Matthew chapter 26, verse 2, and John chapter 13, verse 1. There was also an eclipse of the sun, see Mark chapter 15, verse 33. But according to astronomy, there was an eclipse at Passover during this time only in AD 29 and 33. But AD 29 is too early, since Jesus was baptized that year and he ministered for at least 2 or 3 years. Thus, AD 33 seems to be the time of his death. This also fits with the prediction of Daniel that there would be 483 lunar years between 444 BC and the time of Christ's death. One of the time indicators for Jesus' death is found in John chapter 8, verse 57, in which Jesus' enemies say to him, "You are not yet 50 years old." Even if taken literally, this means they thought he was still in his 40s, and no doubt they added some time for good measure. With a 3-year ministry, this would fit with a mid-30s age at the time of his death. The length of Jesus' ministry. Given that Jesus was baptized in AD 29, the date of his death will be determined by the length of his ministry. The answer to this revolves around how many Passovers are mentioned in the Gospels, and there seems to be either 3 or 4 Passovers during Jesus' ministry. 3 are mentioned explicitly, see John chapter 2, verse 13, chapter 6, verse 4, and chapter 18, verse 28, and some believe Luke chapter 6, verse 1 alludes to another Passover. Another may be implied in John chapter 5, verse 1, which, though not a Passover, may indicate that another year had gone by in which there was a Passover. If there were four Passovers, with 3 years between them, it would fit perfectly with the traditional view that Jesus ministered for 3 1/2 years, adding the extra 1/2 year for a ministry beginning in the fall and going to the spring Passover. The chronological timetable. Building on the indicators mentioned previously, a likely timetable of important dates can be proposed as follows. Christ's birth, 4 or 5 BC. Herod the Great's death, 4 BC. Christ in the temple at age 12, AD 9, see Luke chapter 2, verses 41 through 50. John the Baptist begins ministry, AD 29, see Luke chapter 3. Jesus was baptized, AD 29, see Luke chapter 3, verses 21 through 22. Christ's first Passover after the beginning of his ministry, AD 30, see John chapter 2, verse 13. Christ's second Passover after the beginning of his ministry, AD 31, see John chapter 5, verse 1. Christ's third Passover after the beginning of his ministry, AD 32, see John chapter 6, verse 4. Christ's last Passover and Lord's Supper, AD 33, see John chapter 13. Christ's death, April 3rd, AD 33, see John chapter 19. Christ's ascension, May 14th, AD 33, see Acts chapter 1. Day of Pentecost, May 24th, AD 33, see Acts chapter 2. The geographical background of the Gospels. The geographical setting for the Gospels is depicted by maps of the area at the time. The Holy Land itself consisted of Galilee in the north, Judea in the south, and Samaria in between them. Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, raised in Nazareth in Galilee, and crucified near Jerusalem in Judea. His ministry in the first three Gospels was largely in Galilee, and in John it was mainly in Judea. The literary background of the Gospels. There are two main questions concerning the literary background of the Gospels. Why are there four Gospels? Why are three of them so similar, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and one, John, so different? Before this is answered in more detail, it will be helpful to discuss the differences between the Synoptic Gospels and the Autoptic Gospel. The following contrast will help generalize and summarize the differences. Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, public ministry. Autoptic Gospel, John, private ministry. Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, Galilean ministry. Autoptic Gospel, John, Judean ministry. Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, parables. Autoptic Gospel, John, no parables. Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, human side. Autoptic Gospel, John, divine side. Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, earthly aspect. Autoptic Gospel, John, heavenly aspect. Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, synoptical. Autoptic Gospel, John, supplementary. Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, official. Autoptic Gospel, John, personal. The Synoptic Problem. Let's deal with the Synoptic Problem. Why do the first three Gospels view the ministry of Christ from the same general perspective? To be more specific, why are they so similar in content? And why are there marked differences between them? A whole host of subsidiary questions are involved here. Who wrote first? Who is depending on whom? What sources did each writer have? The basic data of the Gospels. Book, Matthew. Peculiarities, 42%. Coincidences, 58%. Book, Mark. Peculiarities, 7%. Coincidences, 93%. Book, Luke. Peculiarities, 59%. Coincidences, 41%. Book, John. Peculiarities, 92%. Coincidences, 8%. Only 50 to 55 verses are unique to Mark. Matthew has 1,068 verses. 500 are common with Mark. Luke has 1,149 verses. 320 are common with Mark. Mark has 661 verses. 50 to 55 are not in Matthew or Luke. Matthew and Luke have 250 verses in common that are not in Mark. Luke has 580 verses peculiar to itself, which have a Gentile tone. Matthew has 300 verses peculiar to itself, which have a Jewish tone. Some proposed solutions. Numerous theories have been put forth to solve the synoptic problem. Some are held by liberal scholars, some by evangelicals, and some by both, at least in part. The one-source theory, ut evangelium. This theory proposes one primitive gospel from which all three synoptics drew information. Accordingly, the similarities are due to one common source, and the differences result from the individual author's theme, interests, and style. Problems. 1. The disappearance of the original source is difficult to explain. 2. The differences between the three Gospels are difficult to understand. 3. There is no record or manuscripts of any such primitive Gospel. Two-document theory. The two-document theory claims that the similarities between the three Gospels are due to Matthew and Luke following Mark in order and wording, and the differences are explained by positing a hypothetical common source called Q, from the German Quelle, meaning source, from which Matthew and Luke's common material comes. Problems. 1. Q is a purely hypothetical source. There are no manuscripts of it or citations from it. 2. It is inconceivable that Q does not have a passion and a resurrection narrative. This is the heart of the gospel. See 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 19. 3. The absence of Jesus' many miracles betrays an anti-supernatural bias. Mutual use theory. According to mutual use theory, the similarities among the three Gospels are due to two Gospels using the form of the third, for example, Matthew and Luke using Mark. The differences result from their own purpose and way of presentation. Problems. 1. All possible combinations have been held of who used whom, and this weakens the view. 2. This theory does not explain verses that are common to two, but not in the third. 3. While stressing literary identity, it neglects each writer's individuality. Four-document theory. The four-document theory contends that the similarities among the three Gospels result from the other two using Mark, from Rome, A.D. 60, and Q, from Antioch, A.D. 50. And the differences are due to L, Proto-Luke, from Caesarea, which accounts for material unique to Luke, A.D. 60, and M, from Jerusalem, A.D. 65, to account for material unique to Matthew. Problems? 1. The theory is too complicated. 2. Mark is reduced to a literary enigma. 3. It is contrary to the claim and early confirmation of the gospel writers as eyewitnesses. 4. Q is a purely hypothetical document. Fragment theory. The fragment theory holds that various people wrote down certain episodes of the teachings and acts of Jesus, resulting in one teacher having a collection of sayings, another having a collection of miracles, and another the passion narrative. The various Gospels are accounted for as these collections were compiled into their current form. Luke's prologue is used as a support of this theory. See Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. Problems. This theory fails to account for the similarities of the Gospels. Further, it is difficult to explain away the disappearance of these collections. This theory fares no better than theories involving a Q document. Oral tradition theory. The oral tradition theory proposes that the similarities in the Gospels result from all the writers using a common core of fixed oral tradition, and the differences are due to individual writers' choices to fit their different themes. Problems. 1. This theory does not account for the differences in the Gospels. 2. It neglects the role of the Gospel writers as eyewitnesses. See Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. John chapter 19, verse 35, chapter 21, verse 24, Acts chapter 2, verse 32, chapter 4, verses 19 through 20, chapter 10, verse 39, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 through 8, and Hebrews chapter 2, verses 3 through 4, supposing a later date. Form criticism theory. According to this theory, the similarities in the Gospels result from all the writers using an original Q document from which they all copied. Meanwhile, the differences are due to the many different forms this information took in the early church. The information needs to be stripped of its mythological form to get at the original core of truth. Problems. 1. Q is a purely hypothetical source. 2. The theory wrongly assumes late dates for the Gospels, AD 70 to 100. 3. It neglects the role of eyewitnesses. 4. It is contrary to information in the accepted books of Paul, 1 and 2 Corinthians, Romans, Galatians, which were written early, AD 55 to 60, and provide the same basic facts about Christ as the Gospels. Independent eyewitness records theory. The independent eyewitness records view contends that the similarities in the Gospels result from a natural overlap of eyewitness testimony of the same events, and differences are due to individual writers' different choices to fit their respective themes. Problems. This theory has difficulty accounting for the apparent literary identity, but 1. Impact events result in vivid memories. 2. Very little is really literarily identical, only about 8%, which is easily memorized. 3. The writers had supernaturally activated memories. See John chapter 14, verse 26, and chapter 16, verse 13. 4. The Gospel writers make a clear distinction between their words and Jesus' words, as is evident in the editions of the Bible in which Jesus' words are printed in red. And 5. The verified historicity of Acts demonstrates the historical reliability of Dr. Luke and thereby the accuracy of the Gospel of Luke, which he also wrote. See Acts chapter 1, verse 1, and Luke chapter 1, verse 3. The rational background for the Gospels. Often the question of why there are four Gospels is asked. There are at least three basic reasons: veracity, doxology, and universality. The first reason is clearly apologetic. Veracity. Multiple testimony confirms veracity. The Bible declares, by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. See Matthew chapter 18, verse 16, from Deuteronomy chapter 19, verse 15. Something as important as the entrance of God's Son into the world demanded multiple witnesses. Ordinarily, two, or at the most, three would suffice, and four is more than sufficient to confirm the incarnation. Doxology. But the reason for four Gospels is not only theological, it is also doxological, having to do with God's glory. They present a fourfold manifestation of God's glory. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, see John chapter 1, verse 14, which in Ezekiel was manifested as a lion, ox, man, and eagle, see Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 10. Each of these images corresponds to the theme of one of the Gospels: Matthew, the lion, the king of beasts; Mark, the ox, the servant of man; Luke, the man; and John, the eagle, the heavenly one. Universality. The four Gospels are targeted to everyone so that Christ is manifest to all. Matthew presents Christ as king to the Jews. Mark presents him as servant to the Romans. Luke as man to the Greeks, and John as God to the whole world. In short, the four Gospels manifest that the message of Christ is universal. There are many reasons for four Gospels.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.